So welcome everyone to another edition of Math Encounters. And I'd like to express my thanks to the Simons Foundation for sponsoring the series that allows us to bring month after month and year after year, some wonderful mathematicians to share something interesting about what they do with you. I'm very delighted to bring up a good friend of the museum and of mine, Krešimir Penavić. He's a perfectly appropriate person to introduce tonight's talk since he's a principal of the Clai Winery, Clai Vineyard, which is in Croatia. But tonight he's joining us from Pennsylvania. He is also a longtime former employee, almost a quarter of a century at Renaissance Technologies, a very successful hedge fund. And he's been a very longtime friend to MoMath and has been involved with many of our events through the years. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Krešimir Penavić.
Hi, Cindy. Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Welcome to this evening's edition of Mathematics of Wine Tears. I hope your glasses are ready. I have mine here ready. It's white wine, but actually it works quite well. I've been playing here on my desk, and I promise you are in for a fascinating talk. I really enjoyed the afternoon's edition. As Cindy said, this behind me, I wish I was there. This is how our vineyards look. So I think it's a perfect background for a start of this talk, which is really a fascinating intersection of wine and mathematics. And the wine legs, the wine tears, have been and are a huge point of discussion in wine community. And there is, you know, heated debates whether it, you know, has anything to say about the quality of the wine or anything else. But as you're gonna find out today, it's really a problem of physics and it does not appear to have any bearings on the wine quality. So don't discount any wine if it doesn't show nice and thick legs. And there are several other interesting topics that are related to this. And I think, Andrea, you mentioned one also this afternoon, and that is the symmetry, for example, when you study what happens when you pour water into spirits and you get little vertices and you can study how this mixing happens. And also louching, which happens when you have emulsified fennel oil and say ozo or pastis or something, and you pour water and it goes cloudy, and why that happens. In any case, I'm gonna introduce the speaker because we're here to listen to her. She's Professor Andrea Bertozzi of UCLA. And at UCLA, she holds the position of Distinguished Professor of Mathematics and Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering. And she's also a Betsy Wood Knapp Chair for Innovation and Creativity. Andrea got her bachelor's, master's, and PhD in very short succession, finishing in 1991 at Princeton. And she arrived to UCLA after Argonne National Lab, I believe, and a nice long stint at Duke University. In 2018, she was named to National Academy of Sciences, which is a really big honor. And again, I congratulate you for that. Her main areas of interest are nonlinear partial differential equations with applications to fluid dynamics and pattern forming problems, which is exactly the point of tonight's talk. It's just called Tears of the Wine. So I don't want to keep anybody from math and your drinks. So Andrea, please take over. Thank you.
Thank you. Can everyone hear me? I think so. So just wave.
Sounds good.
Okay, very good. Okay, it's really a pleasure to be here. Good evening from Santa Monica, California. It's still the afternoon here. It's only 4 o'clock in California. Bright, beautiful, sunny day, no clouds, pretty typical for the summertime here. So what I'm going to tell you about today is a little background on the science behind Tears of Wine and how math plays a really important role front and center in this research. This is a problem that is near and dear to my heart. I've worked on components of the science going back now 20 years, and it's only been the last couple of years that we've been able to bring together a bunch of different ideas and put them together to develop a quantitative theory for the actual wine tears. So without further ado, I'm gonna share my screen with some slides. And we're going to see a few videos. So I may need to toggle back and forth between the keynote talk and a couple of videos I have online. So let me just start with the keynote. Okay, great. Okay, so the research actually, it is a paper now. It involves several collaborators at UCLA, Yoni Dukler, who is a PhD student, Hong Jiji and Claudia Falcon, who both have been postdoctoral scholars at UCLA. And this is actually a story about how teaching a graduate course can lead to directly to an actual research paper on a kind of popular topic. I was teaching a course in the mechanical and aerospace engineering department, and I was teaching about coding flows, and I thought that the tears of wine problem would be a fun lecture. You know, there is science behind it. I thought I would bring in a live demo and the students could see the live demo, enjoy some wine, and hear about the science. But as I was preparing my lecture, I realized there was basically a hole missing from the theory. And it was a hole that I sort of had some ideas on, but I thought that it would make for a good project for some young researchers. And so this is what we put together. And it's kind of a cool story. And we're gonna go all the way back to some of the history of this problem going back a couple hundred years. And then we're gonna look at some of the more recent quantitative science literature, both experimental and theory, in the last 20 years, and how pieces of this kind of created the current state of knowledge. First of all, towards the end of this, we're going to actually So I'm having some issues with my video player, and sometimes it requires me to restart the software. So hold on a sec. Let me stop sharing. I apologize. It was working just before we started, but this won't take but a second. So I do need to restart that. And that will just take a second. Maybe while this is starting up, I can share the other videos. So let's do that. Okay, so here we go. So there's one video I wanted to share with you that is from a paper that appeared in PhysRev Letters in 2017. And this is not Tears of Wine, but it has a lot in common. So this is an experiment that was done on a horizontal surface with sunflower oil at the bottom, kind of spread on the substrate, and then a mixture of alcohol and water with a dye, with a blue colored dye, is put on top. And it's beautiful, the kind of dynamics that comes out of that. So I thought I'd share that with you. So there's the blue dye, and watch what happens. So what's happening here is we have evaporation of the alcohol leading to a surface tension gradient along the surface that drives the flow outward. And in this particular situation, the oil and the water do not mix. And so because of that, you get these very small blue drops that form. And they form this absolutely gorgeous pattern on this horizontal surface. So that's one video that I wanted to show. And I think I've got my keynote back. So there's another video I could show, but let me get out of this. And let me go to, hopefully this is gonna work now. Okay, now I'd like to go to the actual Tears of Wine. Let's see if this is actually going to run. Okay, I gotta share screen again. Okay, good. So let us, there we go. So this is from our lab. This is a martini glass with port wine. And what you're seeing is the shockwave comes up around the side of the glass, and then these tears emit from it. You can see the tears right here flowing back down into the wine. Now that's the classical Tears of Wine experiment. And actually these two videos that I just showed you have a lot in common in that they both involve a main driving force, which is called a Marangoni stress, and it's because of a surface tension gradient on the air liquid interface. So, all right, so let me scroll forward. There we go. So the story about tears of wine is an old story. It's a balance between the Marangoni surface stress and gravity. So let's talk about the Marangoni surface stress, because that's really the main feature, one of the main features here, but it's not the only feature. So here's a diagram of the martini glass. We could also be looking at a regular wine glass. In our experiments, we tend to like martini glasses, and you can see one in this picture right here. We like them because in terms of reproducibility and in terms of simplifying the equations, the martini glass has a constant cone angle. So the angle of inclination up the side of the glass is a fixed angle. That makes the math a little simpler. We also like to do our experiments with stemless glasses. Why? Because when you have a stem, like we have in this diagram here, the base of the stem can sometimes interfere with the imaging. And that's clear to see from this photo here. This is an image that was taken at UCLA, actually in the office, not even in a lab. And we can see what's going on here is this martini glass with port wine is sitting on top of an overhead projector. So this is an old fashioned, you know, overhead projector from several decades ago. We still have them. And you put the glass right on top of the overhead projector, and then the light shines upward through the glass. It hits a reflective mirror, and then the reflective mirror puts the image on some vertical walls or a screen. So here we are with a screen in the office, and you can see in the background what the image actually looks like on the screen. And what you see looking upward through the glass is you see the rim of the glass here, you see the liquid right here, you see the meniscus, which is where the bulk of the liquid, at the edge of the bulk of the liquid is, and then you see these kinds of ripples forming around that, and that's your tears of wine, and you can see it close up here in this photo where there's a ridge, and then there are these legs that come down, and it's very interesting. What happens is the ridge actually advances up and eventually stops, whereas the tears actually flow in the opposite direction, and this is really counterintuitive. It's quite different from all the other finger formation that we know of and that we observe in commonly in problems that involve these kinds of coating flows with surface tension. And there's a reason for that. There's a reason, at least based on our current theory, which is that this ridge as it advances up the side of the glass is actually a special kind of shockwave. It's not a typical kind. It's what we call an undercompressive wave. And we're gonna go through some of the basic math that will explain that theory. That mathematics involves differential equations, which not everyone who's listening in may know. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna explain the parts of the theory as I can explain them largely with just graphing of functions and looking at the geometry of graphs of various functions. And that should be a little more accessible to a broader audience, I hope. And anyway, the science is fun. So the other thing I wanted to talk about is the actual physics behind the Marangoni stress. So what's going on with that? And this is kind of an important takeaway of the science. If you look at the edge of this region right here, whoops, what you see is that there's this large bulk of wine in the glass. And on the air liquid interface, you have evaporation of alcohol from the fluid into the air, but there's a lot more fluid in the main part of the glass to replenish the alcohol at the surface than there is right here in the meniscus region. So what happens once the evaporation sets in, what happens is that you end up with a differential in the alcohol concentration at the surface, meaning that you'll have more alcohol here and less alcohol at the surface over here. Now it turns out that alcohol as a chemical can change the surface tension of the liquid by quite a lot. And that means that you have a change in the surface tension. And when you have that change in the surface tension, it creates a stress that's like a wind that pushes that surface, and it pushes it from regions of lower surface tension to higher surface tension, which means that it's going to be driving the flow up in this direction here. And that causes fluid to climb the glass. It's really counterintuitive. It's really a chemical process that allows that to happen. It's something that you can't see with your eye, but you can certainly smell the alcohol evaporating. So it's a combination of the geometry of the glass, this chemical differential that leads to a surface tension gradient that causes the fluid to climb. And that has a name. It's called a Marangoni surface stress. And this idea, one more thing I wanted to mention is if this seems very counterintuitive to you, this is very similar to the kind of stress you have when you're driving a car in the rain and the water hits the windshield and the wind blows the water up the windshield. And that's also a surface stress on the water. It's a little different from this chemical stress, but it's more similar than it is different if you just take away the fact that there's actually wind there. So that's just another thing I wanted to mention, that there are other kinds of physics that can lead to these surface stresses. Another example would be, instead of having a chemical gradient, you can have a temperature gradient. And that turns out to be very important in terms of creating the theory for this problem involving tears of wine. Okay, so this idea of Marangoni stress causing these strange flows of alcohol, this goes back in the scientific literature to 1855, a paper in the Philosophical Magazine by James Thomson, who is the elder brother of Lord Kelvin, who is very well known in fluid dynamics. So this phenomenon was first correctly explained in this article dating back to 1855 on certain curious motions observable at the surface of wine and other alcoholic liquors. And so this was a qualitative discussion. The first set of quantitative experiments didn't really happen until the 1990s. And so we're gonna go over some of those, and we're gonna see how to put together all the pieces of the puzzle. So the pieces we're looking at are the Marangoni stress, which we've just discussed, gravity, which plays an important role as well, always has, and the bulk surface tension. We need all three of these physical effects to understand how these unusual wine tears form. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go over some of the basics of these physical effects, how we model them with math equations, and how we can understand some of the dynamics through graphing various features of the math equations. So I'm gonna now switch to from the Marangoni stress to one of the other ingredients, which is gravity. So we can also take some kind of viscous liquid and we can put it on an incline, just like we have the inside of the wine glass. But instead of considering the alcohol concentration gradient as the driving force, we can simply look at what does gravity do. So to see what gravity does, it makes a lot of sense to pour the liquid at the top of an inclined plane and let it flow down the plane. And this is a very simple thing. You can do this in your kitchen. You don't need any fancy experimental apparatus to do this experiment. A very nice paper was published in Nature in 1982 on this problem by Huppert. And what Huppert did was looked at clear fluid on an incline, and he looked at the dynamics of the combination of gravity and surface tension. And so without the surface tension, with just gravity and viscosity, he derived an equation of motion for the thickness of this fluid layer as it flows, and that's h, as a function of just one spatial variable, which is the direction of the downslope. He did not look at the transverse fingering dynamics with just this equation. So this is an equation that involves the motion of the the height of the liquid as a function of time. So this is actually a time derivative. It's a little fuzzy, but we'll see it in another slide, a little less fuzzy. And one spatial derivative, so there's a little calculus here. And then this thing in the bracket is just a constant. These are all physical constants. We've got gravity, we've got the sine of the inclination angle, and we've got the viscosity of the fluid. And so what Hubbard did was he actually wrote down an exact solution to this equation that described a constant volume of fluid flowing down the incline. And he noticed that he could rescale the solution and scale out the physical constants. Here, capital A is the cross-sectional area. So that gives you an idea of what the total volume is involved. So those are the parameters, the viscosity, the total volume, gravity, which is a constant, of course, and the inclination angle. So you can do a bunch of different experiments and you can compare them to each other by rescaling using the, by rescaling with this factor, giving you the scaling constant. And you can see in this picture over here, he did the rescaling somewhat differently, but you can see that he's basically showing that you can take a bunch of different experiments which are shown with different symbols and they should all collapse onto the same plot. And what he's plotting here is something that's very easy to measure. It's the position of the front as a function of time, and it should scale like t to the 1/3, right? And so that's a very, very simple experiment. And then this is sort of a diagram of the flow where you would expect to see kind of increasing thickness of the layer until you came to the abrupt edge, and all of this flows down the surface. So this is an old story, and we're going to now think about the math that he's using here. This is an example of a conservation law, and that equation is one example of a very well-known set of equations called scalar conservation laws. And so here's the general form where we have the height of the liquid versus time and space, and we're looking at one time derivative of that height being balanced by the derivative in space of the flux. And the flux is calculated by looking at the average velocity of the flow multiplied by the height. That gives you the total flux of fluid through any point in space. And by balancing these two effects, we're basically saying that mass is conserved, that there's no liquid disappearing somewhere or being added. If it moves, it's going from one location of space to another location of space. So that's what this equation describes. And it turns out that using some pretty simple calculus, you can show that smooth solutions can be understood using something that we mathematicians call the method of characteristics. And so the way to think about this is by literally differentiating the F and computing out this derivative. So that would give you this equation here. It's the same equation if the solution is smooth. And there is, so now that derivative turns into this product where you have f prime of h, so the derivative of the flux with respect to its argument, and then the derivative in space of the height. And so, so it turns out with just a little bit of calculus of transport equations, we see that this equation literally says that the height function is conserved along characteristics. These are like particles that move with a certain speed, and they're moving with a speed which is the first derivative of F evaluated at that height. So this is basic transport theory. And you don't have to know all the calculus to understand that what it says is that if your height function at one time looks like this graph here, we're going to graph it. So this is the height axis and this is the x-axis. Then you can literally compute for each height, you can compute this, you can plug in that height into this F prime, and that tells you how fast does the solution at this height move. So you're going to translate that piece by a certain speed that's given by that F prime. So the speed for a small value of H is much slower than the speed for a high value of H if in fact F prime is monotone increasing in H, which it is in Hubbard's example. And so that means that if you start with an initial height that's kind of smooth like this, it's going to steepen. The slope is going to steepen, and it might eventually get to a point where there's a jump discontinuity, where suddenly H goes from a big value to a small value. And then we have to figure out how to continue the solution. And that jump discontinuity is an example of what we call a shockwave. It's a really, really simple kind of shockwave. We're not talking about like a supersonic shock in air. We're talking about a shock that is a special kind of discontinuous solution of an equation of this type. And they happen in all different examples in nature. Another example that is often taught in undergraduate math is traffic flow, that you can have traffic jams, and those can be described by shocks as well, using a model that's very similar to the one that I'm showing you here. Okay, so we see that Huppert's model can possibly develop shocks. There's another, I gotta talk a little bit more about the shocks. So once you get this discontinuity, so here's the discontinuity. So we're gonna model that now as just a situation where the height H of the flow has one value H left to the left of the shock, and it's another value H right, HR, on the right-hand side of the shock. So there's your jump discontinuity. And the question is, can we find a solution of some sort to this problem that has a discontinuity that would propagate? And if so, what is the speed of propagation? So it turns out that there is beautiful theory to do this. And involves something called weak solutions, and we're not going to get into that, but I'm going to tell you what the formula is for the speed of the speed of the discontinuity. And that formula is called the Rankine-Hugoniot condition, and it basically says that you have to look at the jump in the flux. So what's the flux here minus the flux over here? And so that's the jump in the flux, and that's in the numerator of this fraction. And in the denominator of the fraction, we have the jump in the height. So it's the jump in the flux divided by the jump in the height. And for those of you who know calculus, you'll notice that if these two heights approach each other, and the limit is HL and HR come together, from calculus, we know that this is just the derivative of F, capital F. So in that limit, as you get to the continuous case, you recover the formula for the characteristic speed. But in the case where you have a jump discontinuity, we actually have to write this other formula for the shock speed. And that has a name, and it's pretty classical now in mathematics. It's called the Rankine-Hugoniot condition of the shock speed. Okay, so we have a formula. So now there's one other kind of solution that we have to think about for these conservation laws, and this is a rarefaction fan. So rarefactions are special similarity solutions. They're special solutions of the equation that have this kind of form. It's a function of x space over time. So think about space over time. As time increases, this denominator gets bigger and bigger, but it's rescaling the spatial variable. So it's basically like taking a shape in space. And then as it evolves in time, it just sort of it inflates like a balloon. It expands out. And so that's the model that we're going to use. So you might wonder, why would you guess this particular shape, this type of function of x over t? Why would you choose that? Well, from a dimensional analysis perspective, you might choose it because the equation that we're studying has one time derivative balancing one space derivative. So that means that the dynamics ought to somehow have time and space balancing each other. So because of that, it's very natural to think about solutions that have this kind of x over t scaling. You know, it's like a symmetry that you expect to recover from these kinds of equations. So, and in fact it is. So if we take that form and we literally plug that form of solution into the partial differential equation, and then we do something called separation of variables, and that's something that undergraduate students typically learn in the first couple of years if they're doing a major in mathematics or physics, they learn separation of variables. So I'm not going to go into how to do that. It's a little bit of calculus. And if you do that exercise of separation of variables and plugging in, you actually can write down the solution. So the non-trivial solution to the rarefaction fan is literally a solution that is F prime inverse of X over T. You either get that shape or you get a constant. So that's what you get from solving for the rarefaction. And so if we go back to Huppert's equation, we notice that his flux function is a cubic. And so that means that the first derivative of the cubic is a quadratic function. And a quadratic function has an inverse that's a square root. So that means that the rarefaction fan for Huppert should actually have the shape of a square root. And what you see in his drawing here is it actually doesn't look like a square root. It looks like he made a bit of a curve here and then it was sort of this flat piece. But actually the real solution that he derives is actually literally a square root shape right here. And then it ends abruptly. And where it ends, so this piece is actually a rarefaction fan. And where it ends is our shock wave. So then the shock is gonna move with some speed, and that speed actually scales like t to the 1/3. And the reason why it's time dependent is because the right-hand side has h rate equals zero, but the left-hand side has a height that's changing in time because information from that rarefaction fan is disappearing into the shock. Okay, so we're gonna learn a little bit more about why information disappears into a shock, but not quite yet, because I wanna go back to the science and the experiments of tears of wine. So we've learned a lot now about the mathematics connected to the gravity part of the problem. What we need to do now is go back and look at the Marangoni stress and what did people study in the past 20 or 30 years on that. So the first paper that really carefully looks at quantitative measurements for tears of wine was written and published by Fournier and Casabat, Neurophysics Letters, in 1992. They have some really beautiful, beautiful images. They did their experiments in a watch glass. So what is that? A watch glass is literally, you know, if you think about like a clock, and it has a slightly curved glass face. It's basically that glass face. So it's basically a shallow bowl almost that has, you know, that's not very steep. So it's not as steep as an actual wine glass. It's fairly shallow. It is made of glass. The inclination angle does vary a bit because of the curvature. And what they did was they put in ethanol water mixture, and they used a very special imaging technique called interferometry to measure the thickness of that wine tear film as it climbs out of from the meniscus. And so that's why you see these beautiful images here. So you can see these interference fringes. These are literally contour lines of equal height thickness. And you can see this beautiful fingering instability at the edge. Right? And then you can see this dark region down here. And this dark region is the meniscus. This is where the bulk of the wine sits. And then you have this Marangoni stress pushing a little bit of wine up out of there. And these experiments were all done on dry surfaces, which means you have to prepare the surface very, very carefully. You can't just stick it in the dishwasher with any old detergent, pull it out and run your experiment, because detergents that are present on that surface can drastically change the dynamics of the coating layer. So they did a lot, they took a lot of care to clean the surfaces and then to do these experiments. One of the things they noticed is that you get these little tendrils that form at the meniscus. And this is something that you can see if you use a fairly high alcohol spirit to drink. With just regular wine, you may not see this effect yourself. But if you use something with a higher alcohol concentration, you will see this sort of star-like behavior. And that behavior triggered the interest of two of my colleagues at MIT, Pekka Hosoi and John Bush, who wrote a beautiful paper on this that got published in 2001 in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics. And one of the things they did was they developed a model, And their model only included the it basically included the Marangoni stress as the dominant effect, and that's and it was for what they were studying. And what they see is that you get these, you can see the tendrils of the meniscus, beautiful, beautiful imagery close up, the tendrils of the meniscus, and here are the fingers of the alcohol water mixture climbing up. And in this case, they're actually doing their experiment not in a glass, but on a flat surface that's on an incline. And this image here shows some really, really pretty close-up pictures of those tendrils at the meniscus. And you might say, I've never seen that in any beverage that I've consumed. And you're right, you probably haven't. Because what they've done is they've put in some small flecks that are shiny, clearoscope, basically fish scales. And what the fish scales do is they reflect light in such a way that you can image not just you know, the details of the tendrils, but you can actually see if the fluid is moving in some kind of pattern. And so you get little convection rolls in here, and that's what's driving this, this shape. And so it's really, really interesting fine scale dynamics, but it's dynamics of the meniscus rather than the dynamics of the tiers of wine. So there were quite a number of years where there wasn't too much new work on this. A paper came out in Nature Scientific Reports in 2015 by Veneris and Simbilla. And they did experiments with both wine and cognac. And what one of the things they did was they did something that hadn't been done in prior experiments, which was they made very, very careful fine scale measurements of the temperature of the surface. And why is that important? That's important because the Marangoni stress, which is a chemically induced stress, is one effect that can cause the fluid to go up the side of the glass. But another effect that can happen that can also cause that is a thermal gradient. So it turns out that surface tension also depends on the temperature. And they argue in this paper that the thermal gradients play an equal role to the Marangoni stress in terms of this, in terms of this stress that allows the wine to climb up the side of the glass. Well, this certainly piqued my interest. And it piqued my interest for a couple of reasons. One is that the kinds of tiers that they're looking at here are what we typically see in a social drinking type environment, like we're going to do today in this talk. It's the typical scenario that we observe with tiers of wine, but it often requires a pre-wet glass to get the full effect. And so what is the nonlinear dynamics that gives us behavior? Well, so it turns out, and I'm giving away the answer here, there's an unusual kind of a shock that forms, and it's called an undercompressive shock. And so we actually cheated a little bit in the sense that the thermal gradient problem was actually understood, you know, basically two decades earlier, almost two decades earlier for thermally driven films, but was never connected to the tiers of wine problem. So now what I wanna do is I wanna go over a little bit more the mathematics behind these basic shockwaves to explain what happens when you put the Marangoni stress or the thermal stress, they have the same equation, it turns out. What happens when you combine that with gravity in the opposite direction? And how can we understand that? By just simple geometry of graphing of functions. Okay, so the Marangoni stress is modeled using, it's a slightly different equation from Huppert's equation, but it's the same general form. So, and it has a name too in the math literature, which is the Invissit-Berger's equation. You don't have to remember that, but you have to remember that that scalar conservation law with the Marangoni stress, with that the chemical gradient or the thermal gradient, because that's a surface stress rather than a body force, the flux is actually quadratic rather than cubic. So this has a quadratic flux, f of h is h squared. And it's the same flux we get with the thermal gradients. So the gravity equation from Huppert has an h cubed instead of an h squared, and that's going to be really important because we're going to put those two together, but not yet. Okay, so the shock speed is, so now we're going to look at that ranking, we're going to revisit the formula for the shock speed in terms of the geometry of our graph of the flux function. So let's take that simple flux function, which is a quadratic, f of h is h squared, and we're going to plot f versus x, and we're going to look at what happens when we plot this function with different arguments for x. Okay, so let's let this curved line be the h squared parabola. Okay, it's a piece of it. We're not plotting the whole parabola, we're just plotting a piece of it. And we're gonna now take a value for our shock. We're gonna take h left over here, so it's gonna be bigger, and then h right is smaller down here in this particular example. And then we're gonna look at the line that connects f of h left with f of h right, that's a chord. So that chord is literally connecting two points on the graph of the flux function. And what we see is that the slope of the chord is has a formula. So when you look at the slope of this line, it's always the rise over the run. So that means that it's f of h left minus f of h right divided by h left minus h right. Okay, and we can write that down, that fraction is right here. And that fraction is exactly the formula for the speed of the shock wave from several slides ago. That is our Rankine-Hugoniot jump condition. And what that tells us is that the speed of the shock wave, we can interpret geometrically as the slope of this chord. And we can also compare that speed, the slope of this chord, to the characteristic speeds on the left and the right states. And we can find those speeds also geometrically because they're just the first derivative of this function f. And graphically, we can graph that as the tangent to this curve. So we can just put in a tangent here and a tangent here. And for any convex function, for any convex function, we know that the tangent here has to be a steeper slope than the slope of this chord, and the slope of this chord is steeper than the tangent down here. And so we can write that down mathematically too. And that just means that shock speed s is larger than the characteristic speed ahead of it and slower than the characteristic speed behind it. So in words, that just means the shock, well, I think it's what I just said, right? The shock speed is less than the characteristic speed behind it, greater than the characteristic speed ahead of it. So the shock is catching up to the material that's in front of it, that in the direction it's heading, but the stuff behind it is flowing even faster. And that's basically what perpetuates the shock. And that formula here, this inequality, has a name as well, and that's called the lax entropy condition. So it's a condition that relates the relative speeds of things on either side of the shock. Okay, that's important for this problem. We even have a little diagram for that. So this is called a characteristic diagram, and it's a different kind of a plot. It's a plot of space versus time. So it's a space-time diagram. And in our space-time diagram, we have a solid line, which is our shock, and we have these arrowed lines, and those are the lines showing the paths traveled by disturbances along characteristics on either side of the shock. And you can see that they're impinging onto the shock from both sides. So, and that's why when Huppert derives his solution for the flow down the incline plane, that's why when you think about material disappearing into the shock, we can think of that as information coming in from the rarefaction fan into the shock and decreasing the overall height, because those taller heights are disappearing into the shock wave. So that's an example of what we call a compressive wave. Now, it's possible in very special circumstances to have a different situation where the characteristics pass through the wave. And in order to do that, you have to go back to that geometry of the graph of the flux. And so we're gonna do that here. And I need to manipulate this. So I'm getting out of presentation mode and I'm just gonna pull this thing off for a minute. So we're now looking at a fancier flux. This is not a convex flux function. Here's F on this axis, H on this axis, and I'm plotting the flux function for the tiers of line problem. And it has two terms. There's an H squared term and there's an H cubed term. And the first term is from the Marangoni stress. My direction of flow is up, not down. So the Marangoni stress has a positive term, but gravity goes against the upward direction. So I have a minus sign there. And so these two effects are fighting each other and they have different powers. So why do they have different powers? They have different powers because the Marangoni stress comes from the surface only, and gravity is a force that's pulling on every single molecule of fluid. It's a body force. And so when you work out something called the lubrication theory to derive these equations, you end up getting different powers because the physics is different. And that's actually quite useful if you want to get really interesting pattern formation, because you get this nonlinear behavior and you get non-convexity of your flux function. Once you have a flux that's non-convex, it opens up the possibility of finding a chord like this one, finding a chord that might connect a left and a right state from here to here, where the chord actually crosses the graph of the flux function. And if you do that, you notice that the tangent vector up here is actually shallower than the slope of this chord, which means that you don't have this, you no longer have the situation where information is coming into the shock from both sides. Okay, and so it turns out that that behavior with this particular flux and with additional physics that gives you the math you need to have these connections, and that's the bulk surface tension. It turns out that that's been studied going back over 20 years. And actually that was work that I did myself with several colleagues, starting with Kazabat in the 1990s. And here's some experimental data from Bob Berenger's lab at Duke when I was on the faculty there. And so this experiment has nothing to do with wine. This is a thermal gradient experiment. This is the thermal case. And we're looking at an oil, and the oil is sitting on a surface, and the surface has variable temperature. It's got a temperature gradient that's linear, very, very carefully controlled along the surface. And that gives us a similar kind of a surface stress by changing the surface tension of the liquid. So what we did here, and this was Jean Mansour who actually did the experiment, he was a postdoc. So what Jean Mansour did was he dipped a flat silicon wafer in the oil, like a dip coating process, and then took it out and put it on this temperature gradient. And so the dip coating, what it does is it gives you kind of a bump of fluid that's already there. And then the question is, what does it do? Well, what it does is it actually climbs up the wafer against gravity, and it climbs up in a really bizarre way. So here's a snapshot in time. And we're looking at interference fringes here again. They did some really beautiful imagery here. So all of these dark lines are basically contour lines showing equal thickness areas of the oil. And you can see going forward in time from B, C, D, E, and F, that these nice thick dark lines are growing fatter and they're growing apart from each other as time advances. And guess what? That is the X over T rarefaction scaling that we talked about. And you can see that here, this is the rarefaction fan. It's getting pretty long as we go later in time. And this is a comparison between numerical simulations of the mathematical equations and the actual experimental data. So there's the rarefaction, but more importantly, there's this gigantic jump here. So that's a shock, and there's another jump over here. That's another shock. These are both actually under compressive shocks. There's two of them. And then disturbances actually travel through this shock and then through this shock and land over here. So it's a really interesting kind of experiment. And at the time we did this, we were not thinking about tears of wine at all. But it's cute. All right, so now what we want to do is we want to take all of these things and we want to put them all together to solve our problem. So, all right, before I move on to this, are there any questions? I think you guys are all drinking, which is good. All right, great. All right, so now what we want to do is we want to see how all this mathematics can be combined into one theory for tears of wine. And this was Yoni's class project in the class that I taught and Yoni took. And so for the tears of wine problem, we're bringing in the Marangoni stress, which is our quadratic flux. We're putting in the gravitational force, pulling things back down. That's the cubic flux term here. And then we have other physics on the right-hand side. So the other physics is kind of higher order, and I'm not going to get into the details of the math, but I will say that this first term with four space derivatives is our bulk surface tension. That comes from the bulk surface tension. And the second term is the normal component of gravity, which is a stabilizing term. And it turns out that this bulk surface tension is what allows for these non-classical shocks to exist mathematically. They would not exist otherwise. So that's kind of interesting too. And so now what I'm gonna do, and I need to stop this, is to show you an experiment with this geometry that we actually did at UCLA. So this is our experiment, and it is, it's done in a martini glass. And it's with the overhead projector. So what you're seeing on the right-hand side is the actual image. And on the left-hand side is a reflection of that image with some image processing to highlight the shockwave. So what we're gonna see here is a shockwave a circular one that's gonna emerge from the meniscus. It's gonna start traveling outward and it's gonna shed wine tears. So let's watch that. So you can see that wave starting to form around the edge of the meniscus. You can see it start to go out, and you can see those beautiful wine tear fingers forming, going in the opposite direction of the travel of the wave. Okay, and this is something that we're going to do in real time with our own experiments today. Anybody can do this. You can do this in a restaurant. What you need to do, if you're going to do the experiment, is you need to have a beverage that has a sufficiently high alcohol concentration. A good solid red wine, a port wine is excellent, or even a spirit. So for example, I've got a bottle of Knob Creek, and that also works pretty well, or cognac. And you also need to make sure that you're not using cold beverages. So if your wine has been sitting in a wine cellar at, you know, 58 degrees or 62 degrees or whatever temperature you put the wine cellar at, it's not going to work so well because the cooler temperature will suppress these effects. Likewise, if you like to drink your Knob Creek on the rocks, it's probably not going to work so well because, again, the two things will happen. The ice will dilute the alcohol concentration, and the ice will turn everything cold, which will suppress alcohol evaporation and also thermal effects, obviously. So, all right, so you might say, well, okay, that's really cool. You had a circular shock wave, and there it is with the snapshots, but how do you know it's an undercompressive shock? Well, this is where you have to dust off your computer and solve that fancy equation with all those derivatives. And so, so fortunately, we had Hong Ji and Claudia, who were really good at doing that kind of work, And here are some beautiful results. So here's a snapshot with several snapshots in time at different times for an initial condition corresponding to that pre-wet glass. And then the meniscus is at x equals zero. But the meniscus actually has sufficient curvature that it literally forces, and very, very quickly in time, it forces what's effectively a jump discontinuity. And then out of that emerges this very complex structure. And the structure emerges because of all the physics in the equation. So what do we see in the structure? We see a rarefaction fan down here. You can see that it expands out in time. It has that beautiful X over T scaling. And we also see a jump, what looks like a jump discontinuity. It's not quite, because if you look closely, it's actually smooth. But the smoothness comes from the bulk surface tension. So on a small length scale, that bulk surface tension produces a lovely capillary ridge. But on a bigger scale, on this scale, we see it as effectively as a jump discontinuity. We can go and measure that jump, and we can see that it indeed satisfies the criteria for what we call a reverse under compressive shock. So the characteristics are going in, you know, in a different direction. Okay, and so, and there's also another little mini shock that's opening up over here. And you can see that that grows in time too. It's basically the rarefaction separating from the under compressive shock. And that's another signature that it's under compressive. If this were a compressive wave and it started off connected to a rarefaction fan, they would be stuck to each other. And that's a signature that says that it's a compressive wave. If they pull apart from each other because they have different speeds, if they're separating with different speeds, that's one of the signatures of the under compressive wave. Okay, so now the other thing we did with our experiment, because we do not have a lot of fancy apparatus to do interferometry, we do not have accurate height measurements of that experiment. So instead of trying to match quantitatively the simulation to the experiment, we did a bunch of simulations with different heights. And the reason for doing that is to show that there's quite a range of heights for which you get the same kind of structures. So phenomenologically, this is fairly robust. There's a range of pre-wet thicknesses for which you expect to see these under compressive shocks, where if we do the geometric picture of our flux versus the height h, we see that chord crossing the flux function. And those are two different values right there. The other thing that I wanted to mention is that the full math requires the geometry of the wine glass. Because that wine glass, those of you at home, I bet not everybody has a martini glass. I bet some of you have, like I have a martini glass here, but I bet some of you actually have bell-shaped wine glasses. And those glasses have different angles as you climb up the side, so you have to factor all of that in to the mathematics, and it gets kind of hairy. And so we, you know, sometimes theorists, because we're theorists, sometimes the theorists, if they're going to do simple experiments, they like to keep the experiment as close to the theory as possible, right? So that's what we did here. Now, I wouldn't recommend drinking wine out of a martini glass. You're going to lose a lot of the bouquet if you do that. But for doing experiments on the tears of wine phenomenon, it's a really nice shaped glass to use. And so one can actually derive the full equations for the martini glass, where you have an additional pressure term from the azimuthal curvature. But because the inclination angle is constant, it's not that different. And one can even do the numerics of both and see that, you know, this we compare side by side a martini glass with the cone angle from the experiment versus a flat plate that would have the same angle of inclination. And you can see they're off by a bit, but phenomenologically, it's pretty similar. So, all right, so that concludes the math for the tears of wine problem, where how we know it today. And in particular, it concludes something that really hadn't been discussed well in the literature, which is how do we understand this problem for the pre-wet glass where you swirl the wine ahead of time. This is something that you're gonna do if you're drinking the wine in a social drinking situation. And it's important to be able to look at this experiment because it's much more reproducible than experiments on dry surfaces where the surface has to be really, really carefully prepared. So I think that's what I have to say. There's a lot of research still that can be done, like numerical experiments on the fully 2D problem and modeling for that, the general curvature of the glass, how to model the evaporation rate, lots of open problems still. But I think it's really neat to see this connection between basic theory of conservation laws and this beautiful problem that goes back several centuries in the scientific literature. So are we ready to move on to, I have some papers here, but that's fine. This is a public lecture. So I wanna move on to the demo, the live demo. So I think what we're gonna do is switch over to the phone. And let's see, so to do that, I have to start the video. And let me stop sharing this screen. Okay, excellent. All right, so let me, good, okay. So, excellent. So now what we're gonna do is a live demo. So everybody who's got their own experiment at home, let's see, my screen's freezing here. Okay, good, we have time, all right. So, all right, so what we're gonna do is we're going to take our alcohol. So I need to get everything lined up because I only have two hands here. And I'm a lefty, so I gotta put my, there we go. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna have a flashlight ready because we're gonna use the flashlight in the same role that we use the overhead projector in our experiments in the lab. Only it's gonna shine from above and it's gonna shine directly onto a light colored surface. I'm using a white tablecloth here. And to do this experiment, you're gonna take, here I have port wine. I'm gonna pour my port wine into the martini glass, not too high, you know, that should be enough. Okay, we have some bubbles in there, so I wanna get rid of the bubbles. Very scientific method for bubble removal. Okay, good. We've got a napkin here so I don't get wine on my nice surface. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put a cover over the wine, over the glass. So the cover plays an important role. It keeps the alcohol from evaporating. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm going to swirl that wine around in the glass so we get a nice coating, not like all the way up to the cover, but we want to get a nice coating of wine on the inside of the glass. Now what I'm going to do is let it stop swirling. There it goes. Okay, so now I'm going to pull the cover off and we're going to look at, there we go. We're going to look at, oh, there we go. Can everyone see the shadow of the meniscus there? And can you see those wine tears forming? I can. Yep, there they are. Beautiful. There we go. And you can see some other ones up high too. Can try it over on this side. There we go. It likes to change the, my phone thinks it knows the right orientation. I guess that's gravitational effect. And then we can also look at the view from the side. And that might be easier. See if I can show it like this. Yeah, from the side, we can also see some wine tears. I guess I gotta get way down here. There we go. So from the side, you can really see the wine tears. And we can also see Sophia Kovalevskaya up there in the top left-hand corner. So she was a famous mathematician. All right. And then again, from the top, really, really pretty. Look at all those legs up there. We can see the legs now from the top view. Okay, hopefully people have done this at home. We can do another experiment. We can do another experiment with our whiskey in case we want to see how it works with a higher alcohol concentration. So I have, oh, you switched me over now. Let's All right, let's put me back on this view. Okay. All right. My phone keeps on asking if I want to have the audio, and I'm like, no. All right. So. All righty. So we have whiskey. A little bit of Knob Creek in there. And if you have some, Kahlua, by the way, works pretty well. We use Kahlua. I was in Adelaide giving a talk on this in Australia. And I did not have much in the way of alcohol that I could take on the plane with me to Australia. Of course, they have their own wine down there that's pretty good. So, but you know, I was walking into campus and my friend, my collaborator there, Yvonne Stokes, had a bottle of Kahlua that she brought to the talk. And that worked pretty well too. So here we are swirling the Knob Creek around in the martini glass. And we're gonna let it stop splashing around there. We're gonna get our flashlight ready. And we're going to lift the paper up and we're gonna look for that meniscus again. And there it is, I see it. Yep. Yeah, it's a little harder to see on this one because the tears are smaller, they're skinnier. But I can see them with my eye. I want to see if I can get, there we go. That's it, right there. You can see on the right-hand edge there in the shadow, you can see those little tears. Now, this is a higher alcohol concentration liquid, so you've got a bigger gradient. So one thing about using like whiskey or something, you can see this effect even with a vertical, even in a vertical glass, you can use a highball glass, you should be able to see it. Just don't drink it on the rocks. So you have to drink your whiskey and your cognac neat. You can't drink it on the rocks if you want to see this effect typically. And we also see some big tears forming up at the top. Here we go on this side. I think we can see, oh yeah, there we go. So we can get the camera on that. There they are. You can see on the other side, there are some nice big tears forming up high on the whiskey. Yeah, some really nice ones. Should put the flashlight up higher. There we go. Okay. All right, so hopefully people did this at home and they got to see some interesting patterns. I think we can switch back to computer. So I've got two links here. One is on my phone and the other is on the computer. So I hope you've all had a great time today. I hope you're enjoying your beverages at home. I see there are a few, comments here, lots of friendly hellos. How do you alter, oh, Jean Taylor, hi Jean, I know Jean Taylor. How do we alter H infinity in experiments? Doesn't wedding matter? Yeah, so yes, the wedding absolutely does matter, and that's why we're doing this pre-wet surface, because we don't have to worry about contact lines so much if we do a pre-coat surface. Okay, great. I saw that was so cool. Thank you, Amanda. I'm glad you found the
And if anybody has any questions about what you're seeing here or results that you've had, just put them out here now. We've got a little bit of time.
Yeah, we sure do.
Yeah.
I might have a little Knob Creek, huh?
What is the alcohol content difference between those two?
Yeah, this one, I have to remember, this one is 19.5% as purchase. Now I bought this bottle in February for a lecture that I gave at UC San Diego, and it's the same bottle, so it's already been opened. So it probably isn't quite 19.5% anymore, but it's reasonably high. Now the Knob Creek packs a punch, I'll tell you that. I just had a swig. The Knob Creek comes bottled with 50% alcohol by volume. So it's much higher.
So there's a question, what other fluids would work with this?
especially for a school teacher who wants to do this in school.
If you want to do this at school, and you don't want to bring in alcoholic beverages, you basically are out of luck, honestly.
Can you use what if it's not, as long as no one drinks it, what about isopropyl alcohol, rubbing alcohol?
Yeah, if nobody's going to drink it, then bring in a beverage, I would say, because, you know, kids are likely to drink stuff anyway. Yeah. So I wouldn't use anything toxic. I would bring in something that's not going to kill them if they drink it, right? So.
Jean is asking, what about glycerol?
Glycerol, Jean, very good question. So glycerol will only give you the gravitational effect. It will not give you the Marangoni stress. So you're going to be back in the situation that Huppert was in. So you're only gonna see what Huppert saw in his experiment, stuff flowing down, that's it. And so I'll tell you, there's a lovely YouTube video by Physics Girl. She has her own channel, you know, she's connected to PBS and she does beautiful 10-minute videos about all sorts of science. So she was actually at UCLA, doing filming our lab and filming some of the stuff we did. And she did her own kitchen experiment in that video where she had wine, whiskey, milk, and orange juice. And the orange juice and the milk did not form tears, and the wine and the whiskey did. So you really need to have that Marangoni stress or you're just not gonna see this effect at all.
And that's because you have these two different things that evaporate at different rates. That's the key.
The key is that you need something that gives you a surface stress and you need to balance it with gravity. So you could try putting wind in, right? So if you're driving, don't do the experiment if you're driving, but if you're a passenger in the car, you might actually get to see this kind of behavior by chance if it's set up right. If there's rain hitting the windshield of your car, gravity's pulling it back down. At the right speed and at the right initial condition, you can see stuff that looks like this on the windshield of your car. But it's a little hard to control that, right? It's a little hard to control that if you're driving in traffic.
Another question, do dissolved sugar or other wine constituents affect the tears?
Very good question. We don't really know. I'll tell you that the full physics for the actual tears, I think may require a little bit more work. We've started working on this, trying to do simulations of the full dynamics. And I think there's a little more to it. You know, we have to think about the role of the temperature and how that might be carried with the flow. And so that's a piece of the model that's not in this. We haven't put in any temperature effects other than that you could fold them into the surface tension gradient, which is sort of what, you know, Venerus and Simbello were kind of insinuating in their 2015 paper, right? But, you know, if you actually have pieces of wine that are slightly different temperatures and they go, and that stuff forms a tear and then it falls down, it's gonna carry the material with that temperature with it, you know, because it happens on a pretty fast time scale, right? So there's a little more to the story, I think. But in terms of like the generic large scale structures, you know, this is kind of a neat story that brings together some interesting math with some really classical physics. It's the perfect kind of thing for a mathematician to work on without a fancy lab.
So Jean actually suggests that glycerol as a component in wine may be a contributing factor.
You know, it would be a contributing factor only if it affects the kinds of physics that we're talking about. And I don't know enough about the chemistry of glycerol and wine. So that's about all I can say in terms of my own knowledge. So now Zach Dane wants to know, does the color of the wine impact the tears? The color of the wine impacts the optics and how you visualize the tears. So if you're trying to see them through the side of the glass, they're easier to visualize and take pictures of if the alcohol is a dark color rather than being a clear color.
What if you're crying into your glass of wine? Does that have an effect on things?
You mean like physical tears, like from your eyes? Yeah, that adds some physics we haven't really looked at, right?
Here's a couple questions in one question. I noticed that the experiment was not done on a vibration-free surface. Would doing it in a vibration-free surface alter the patterns in any way? And I'm not sure that, you know, might be seem pretty stable to me, but also then the other question.
Oh no, I like the question very much.
Okay, but then he asks the second question, also, has this experiment been done using interferometry to collect measurements?
Yeah, those are great questions. So, you know, I'm not an experimental. I work with experimentalists at UCLA who are fantastic, but they're a little more interested in working on problems that are directly connected to modern technology. So I'm working with them on other things like fiber coating. We're looking at a design for desalination using coating of fibers, and that's with Suntech Ju and mechanical engineering. And we're also looking at microfluidic encapsulations using complex minimal surface design. And that's more of a static problem largely that doesn't really have a Marangoni stress in it. So that means that, like, for the tears and wine problem, this started off as a fun thing. And since I'm not an experimentalist, I don't have all that training in the optics, we didn't go to the extent of trying to do interferometry. I think if somebody out there in the world wants to do it, it would be fun. And we have the background to do the theory on that. So, you know, that would be a neat thing to do. We were able to put enough of the science together without that to be able to write a pretty convincing theory paper. But it would be really cool if somebody wanted to experimentally verify some of the, you know, quantitatively some of the theory that we've developed. That would be really cool. What was the other? Oh, vibrationless table. That's right. So there are experts who do really, really serious experiments on, you know, involving surface tension that need that kind of environment. Jacob Israelashvili at Santa Barbara is one such person. I've seen that kind of apparatus be really, really necessary for very long time experiments looking at things like coarsening dynamics, where vibrations can cause merging to happen that, you know, you want to try to eliminate. We weren't interested in that. We actually wanted to understand the math associated with the kinds of tears and wine that you see in a social drinking kind of environment. So if you're in California, you're definitely not vibration free if you're doing social drinking, right? Because occasionally the earth shakes around here, right? Occasionally. Or if you're in any big city with trucks and things like that, right? So, you know, that's what we were after. We wanted to be able to figure out something that was kind of ubiquitous in a situation where you might be in a restaurant, right? So that's
what the question. So does the old explanation still hold that the tears basically indicate the alcoholic strength?
Yeah, that's right. So the one piece of physics related to the alcohol is that quadratic flux term, and the strength of that term is determined by the strength of the surface tension gradient, and that in turn is going to be related to how much alcohol you have.
So I guess you have to keep other things constant. So if it were a very hot, dry day in Arizona or just outside, I suppose you're going to get stronger results regardless of the wine than if you are humid.
That's right. Cold. Very possibly. Yeah, sure. So humidity, atmospheric humidity. Absolutely. That's right. So if you're really going to be careful with an experiment like this, you want to be able to control a bunch of things. We decided we were going to develop a theory that would explain a general range of what you would do in an experiment. And because of that, we felt it wasn't necessary to actually measure empirically that range, although it is something that would be cool for somebody who's really skilled at doing those kinds of experiments. It would be a neat thing to do.
So I've got a question. Is there something in this work where there's a result something that has emerged from your analysis and your group's analysis that has proven to explain something else in the world? Or is there some phenomenon out there that is the same as what's going on in the wine glass?
What I would say is that we're working on loosely related stuff. So some of the, you know, some of the under the hood details that you're not hearing me talk about because they're too technical, some of those details are very helpful in some of the other research we're doing that does have direct application. You know, I mean, microfluidics is really important for things like, you know, medical assays. You know, new technology in that direction could be quite helpful for doing large batch testing for coronavirus, for example, right? So there's a lot of potential applications there. Fiber coating arises in other kinds of industrial applications. You know, literally if you're making wire and you have to put a coating on it, that's a simple example. But like I say, there are other examples like desalination, you know, which is important for modern society and environmental concerns. So that's another example where we're looking at the combination of the dynamics of surface tension, gravity. In that case, we have the wind, right? So we have that wind phenomenon in that particular application. So we may be looking at different kinds of patterns because of the setup of the experiment, but nevertheless, the physics is very similar and the modeling has a lot in common.
Andrea, you can see that Jean is asking another question.
The dip experiment. Yes, Jean. In the dip experiment, was the surface coated with oil before the dip? Effectively, yes, because the dip coats the surface. But we did experiments on dry surfaces too. I will say we did the dry experiments too. That's another set of papers that I didn't cite. We also found under compressive shocks in those experiments, but there was a transition in the inclination angle from compressive to under compressive in those experiments. And that was work done by Cazabat in Paris and her team. She says, but the oil is sliding down until you put it on the thermal gradient and then it goes up.
Well, all right. All I can say is I look forward to the museum being open again, and then we can all arrive and have a toast and look very closely into our glasses, and we'll make sure to bring flashlights.
Thank you all for joining us today.
Yes.